This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. To help us rejoice today, we have the members of the Salem Lutheran Praise Band that will be providing our music this morning. Before we get to their opening number, however, I'll direct your attention to the screens for this month's edition of the Wells Connection.
Hi, I'm Wells President Mark Schrader. Risen Savior, started as a home mission church in Lakewood Ranch, Florida, recently became a self-supporting congregation. In August of 2020, they opened a preschool. In addition to teaching children about Jesus, the congregation has been active, connecting and building bridges to parents.
It's Harvest Festival at Risen Savior. A fun, festive family event for the children who attend the church's preschool. But there's something else going on here. Members of the congregation, even those without small children, are here too. They're connecting with parents, creating an inviting atmosphere, and building relationships.
We've invited our congregational members to come and just to be a part of the school and to get to know the children and the families and trying to merge those two into one family.
Building that connection between the classroom and the church has been a special focus for Risen Savior's preschool director, Maria Jimenez, and the entire congregation.
God called me. He just placed in my heart a special place for these young children. Doing the early childhood ministry, it's not just about the children, but we are ministering to our parents that are coming in, and the way to do that, building those relationships with them.
The growing Lakewood Ranch area attracts young families with children. Seeing this growth, Risen Savior realized a children's ministry could help them connect more families to the gospel message.
And as we got to know our community, we saw there is a big need for Christian education, and especially at the preschool level. And God has been richly blessing it the last year and a half with a lot of families who are coming and giving us a lot of opportunities to share Christ with them.
Case in point is the Davis family, who are new to the area, without a church home, looking for quality education. They enrolled their son, Billy.
How great it was for Billy, really, in those first few weeks, even he would come home and talk about God and talk
and sing his cute little songs. It was so cute.
And those kinds of things, which kind of brought us back to maybe, you know, that we should be a little bit more involved and get him growing up in a church community.
The preschool has grown from 20 students to over 70, with a waiting list. Families like the Davises are part of that growth. In addition, Risen Savior is working to daughter a mission church in Parrish. Certainly, these blessings are from the Lord and demonstrate how He is working through many church members.
The goal is a warm, welcoming environment where someone walks into our congregations or our schools and feels connected right from the get-go, that there are people there that care about them.
Our Synod has developed a program to help congregations everywhere build that bridge from children's ministries and schools to church membership. It's called Telling the Next Generation.
The purpose of Telling the Next Generation is help a congregation have a plan. When they come, how do we connect with them? How do we build relationships? And then how do we connect them with Jesus?
Our quality schools bring people to our doors. But the next step, church membership, doesn't happen automatically. It requires an intentional effort by all of us to reach out to school families as we reflect an atmosphere of Christian love.
As you've seen, the blessings at Risen Savior have led to efforts to plant a new home mission church 20 minutes north in Parrish, Florida, just east of Tampa Bay. We pray the Lord blesses this new mission to connect with many more families, young and old, so more souls can hear about Jesus Christ. Learn more and stay updated on progress at wells.net/ home missions.
Our praise band continues with their opening anthem, Hymn of Heaven. The words of this song and all their other songs will be projected on the screen. I don't think they would object if you would sing along if you know those hymns. We rise. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. God invites us to come into his presence and worship him with honest and repentant hearts. So let us acknowledge our sin to him, asking for and trusting in his forgiveness. Holy God, merciful Father, we confess that we are sinful. Every day we turn away from your will. We do not love you and each other as we should. We have disobeyed you and deserve to be punished. But we are truly sorry for our sins, and trusting in Jesus, we pray, have mercy on us and forgive us. Our God is the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the eternal and unchanging Almighty. He alone has power over sin, death, and the devil, power that he brought to bear for you at the cross and at the tomb. Because Christ died, your sins are forgiven. Because Christ lives, your own resurrection is guaranteed. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Let us pray. O risen Lord, you came to your disciples and took away their fears with your word of peace. Come to us also by your word and sacrament, and banish our fears with the comforting assurance of your abiding presence. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
For our first scripture reading today, we turn to Acts chapter 5, verse 12, and then also verses 17 through 32. We must obey God rather than men. The apostles performed many signs and wonders among the people, and all the believers used to meet together in Solomon's colonnade. Then the high priest and all his associates, who were members of the party of the Sadducees, were filled with jealousy. They arrested the apostles and put them in the public jail. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened the doors of the jail and brought them out. "Go stand in temple courts," he said, "and tell the people all about this new life." At daybreak, they entered the temple courts, as they had been told, and began to teach the people. When the high priest and his associates arrived, they called together the Sanhedrin, the full assembly of the elders of Israel, and sent to the jail for the apostles. But on arriving at the jail, the officers did not find them there. So they went back and reported, "We found the jail securely locked, with the guards standing at the doors, but when we opened them, we found no one inside." On hearing this report, the captain of the temple guard and the chief priests were at a loss, wondering what this might lead to. Then someone came and said, "Look, the men you put in jail are standing in the temple courts teaching the people." At that, the captain went with his officers and brought the apostles. They did not use force because they feared that the people would stone them. The apostles were brought in and made to appear before the Sanhedrin to be questioned by the high priest. "We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name," he said. "You have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood." Peter and the other apostles replied, "We must obey God rather than human beings. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead, whom you had killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him to his own right hand as Prince and Savior, that he might bring Israel to repentance and forgive their sins. We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." This is the word of our Lord. Blessed indeed are those who hear the word of God and live by it. Amen. For our second scripture reading today, we turn to Revelation chapter 1, beginning with verse 4. Here, John sees a vision of the risen and all-powerful Lord Jesus Christ. "John, to the seven churches in the province of Asia, grace and peace to you from him who is, and who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And all people on earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus, was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. On the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, which said, "Write on a scroll what you see and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea." I turned around to see the voice that was speaking to me. And when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. And among the lampstands was someone like a son of man, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet, with a golden sash around his chest. The hair on his head was white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like blazing fire. His feet were like bronze glowing in a furnace, and his voice was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand, he held 7 stars, and coming out of his mouth was a sharp, double-edged sword. His face was like the sun shining in all its brilliance. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and said, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and now, look, I am alive forever and ever. And I hold the keys of death and Hades." This is the word of our Lord.
Yeah.
to the immortal, invisible, only wise God be power and honor and glory and praise forever and ever. Amen. The word of God for our devotion today is taken from John chapter 20, verses 24 through 31, and we'll go through those verses as we go through our sermon for today. And so, in the name of your victorious and risen Savior, Christ Jesus, who is coming again on that glorious day, my dear brothers and my dear sisters in Christ, it is 1 week ago that we celebrated the victorious, glorious, joyous resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Death defeated, hell conquered, sin dead and buried and gone forever. What a day. And if your home was anything like my home, we really rejoiced that day. First with a couple of nice worship services on Easter Sunday morning here, and then with a fantastic meal and great family time in the afternoon. But that was a week ago. And these days, a lot can happen in the space of just 1 week. And maybe for you, in this past week, there was some bad news that crept into your life to cause you some doubts. Maybe there was some worrisome news that strolled into your life to chip away at that Easter confidence of yours. And now you're thinking, all that good news last week about Jesus and his resurrection and what it means to me, could it be that all of that was just too good to be true? And whether or not you had those kinds of feelings last week, here's the truth, that Satan always has and Satan always will try to get you to doubt the resurrection of Jesus and doubt the glorious hope that that resurrection brings, and really to doubt anything that's in the Bible. And so, in that sense, you and I can relate to Thomas in our text, who just 1 week after Easter had some doubts of his own. And Thomas' experience today will teach us, as our theme says, stop doubting and believe. Stop doubting and believe because the risen Christ appeared to Thomas and to many others. Stop doubting and believe because the risen Christ inspired John and many others. So our text begins this way. Follow along with me. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus is a word that means twin. So obviously Thomas was a twin, but we don't know anything about his twin brother or twin sister. But Thomas, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came a week earlier in that upper room, the first Easter Sunday evening. And where was Thomas a week before? I don't know. Keeping his options open, maybe? Hiding out somewhere else, maybe? I don't know. But I do know this. The other disciples told Thomas, we have seen the Lord. And so 10 of Thomas's closest friends insisted that the Lord had risen from the dead. And that's just what matched what Jesus had previously said over and over again, that he would rise from the dead. But Thomas said to them, unless I see the nail marks in his hands, the holes where the spikes went, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, where that Roman soldier had thrust that spear just to make sure Jesus was dead, I will not believe it, Thomas says. And maybe you remember from the Bible that this kind of grumpiness was sort of typical of Thomas. A while before the resurrection, Jesus had told his disciples that he was going to Jerusalem to raise Lazarus from the dead. And that's when Thomas sort of sarcastically said, "Yeah, let's all go to Jerusalem so we can die with you, Jesus." There was another time when Jesus told his disciples that they knew the way to the Father's house in heaven. And Thomas said, "We don't know where you're going, Lord. We don't know the way." And now here, he's saying, "Look, fellas, I love you, but I saw those spikes driven into Jesus' flesh. I saw that spear thrust into his side. I saw Jesus die with my own eyes. And unless I see Jesus alive again with my own eyes, I'm not going to believe it." You're not going to pull a fast one on Thomas. Well, going on. A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and this time Thomas was with them. And though the doors were locked, lo and behold, all of a sudden, Jesus came. He stands right there, and he said to them, "Peace be with you." Peace be with you, that was the standard Jewish greeting back then. Shalom Aleichem, peace be with you. But it never had as much meaning as it did after the resurrection of Christ. Peace be with you. Peace with God. And consequently, peace with others. And even more than that, peace for troubled minds and peace for hurting hearts. All through the forgiveness won by Jesus, all through the life guaranteed by his resurrection. Peace be with you. And then he sort of turns to Thomas, and I can imagine with a big smile on his face, he motions Thomas to come on over and says, "Put your fingers here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Thomas, you just said that you needed proof that I had risen from the dead. I know you said it because I am the omniscient God and I know all things. I heard you say it because I'm the omnipresent God. I was present in the room when you said it. I'm present everywhere. Stop doubting and believe, Thomas." Literally in Greek, it says something like, "Don't become an unbeliever. Rather, a believer." And with that, God the Son, Jesus Christ, won Thomas' heart. Here, Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." And then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed." But remember what the writer to the Hebrews said about believing, about faith? Faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. And so Jesus says, "Blessed are those who have not seen." And who was Jesus talking about there? Is he talking about guys from the Old Testament, Abraham, Moses, David, Joseph? Gals from the Old Testament, Sarah, Rebecca, Ruth, Esther? Was he talking about you? And me, blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. And so, my friends, what we celebrated this last Sunday, the Easter morning resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, did that really happen? None of us were there to see it happen. Can we be sure that Jesus rose from the dead? Yes. Emphatically yes. No, you and I weren't there to see it happen, but the resurrected Christ was witnessed by many. He was first witnessed by a small handful of women, and then he was witnessed by a larger handful of the apostles. And then, according to St. Paul, he was seen by 500 believers at one time. And that's not even to mention that at least two of the apostles, the apostle Paul and the apostle John, saw the risen Christ with their own eyes years later, maybe decades later, after Christ had risen. Plus, on top of all of that, you certainly could say that God Himself witnessed the resurrection of Christ Jesus. And who are we to argue with God? But does it even matter that Jesus rose from the dead? Again, emphatically, yes, it does. Christ is risen. Death is defeated. Hell is conquered. Your sin is dead and gone and buried forever. You will live with Jesus forever and ever. Paradise is yours, and you now glow with the very righteousness of Christ in the sight of God because of that resurrection of Christ Jesus. Now, that's about half of what we need to know if you and I are going to stop doubting and believe. The risen Christ appeared to Thomas and to many others. And maybe that would be enough for most of us, just that. But our over-generous Savior gives us even more. Stop doubting and believe, because that risen Christ inspired John and many others. And listen to how John starts talking about that. He says, Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book, the book of John, the Gospel of John. So imagine that. In the Gospel of John, John had spoken about Jesus changing water into wine, healing the official's dying son. He had spoken about Jesus healing the lame man at the pool of Bethesda. He had written about Jesus changing just a little bit of bread and a few fish into a meal for thousands of people. He had written about Jesus walking on water. He had written about Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. And last but not least, he had written about Jesus raising Jesus from the dead, which adds a degree of difficulty when it comes to miracles, a dead man raising himself. And then on top of all that, the other gospel writers tell us that Jesus performed 30, maybe 40 other miracles. And so John concludes his whole gospel with these words. Jesus did many other things as well. And if every one of them were written down, I suppose that even the whole world would not have room for the books that would be written. And then in the last verse of our text, he says, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the promised one, the anointed one, the prophet, the priest, the king that's better than every other prophet, priest, and king. And that you might believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Life right now, through the forgiveness of your sins, life forever in eternal glory. So all that joy that we were feeling last Sunday, all that resurrection joy, was that based on fact or fiction? Because again, none of us were there to see it happen. Can we really be sure that Jesus rose from the dead? Yes. Emphatically, yes. We were not there to see it. But there are many eyewitnesses who did see it, and they have preserved it for us right here in Holy Scripture. Those eyewitness accounts from Matthew, from Mark, from Luke, from John, from the Apostle Paul, from the Apostle Peter, from James, from Jude. They all wrote about Jesus' resurrection from the dead. And then, maybe even more than that, it was God himself who inspired these men to write down these accounts of Jesus' resurrection. What, we're going to call God a liar about all of that? And again, does it even matter that Jesus rose from the dead? Emphatically, yes. Jesus lives. Do you feel the relief? All those sins that were crushing you down, Jesus has lifted them away from you and buried them in his tomb forever. Jesus lives. Do you feel the comfort? The death that you dread so much, your own or that of a loved one, Jesus has turned that death into the doorway to eternal life with him. Jesus lives. Do you feel the freedom? You are free from the fear of hell because Jesus suffered it for you. He damned damnation for you forever. So, stop doubting and believe. God himself, I witnessed Jesus' resurrection for you, along with many others. God himself inspired writers to write down the resurrection of Christ Jesus, many of them for you. So undoubtedly, Jesus has risen from the dead. And undoubtedly, your salvation is assured because of it. I guess the real question now is this. How is that going to affect you? What are you going to do with that? Is it going to change the way that you live your day-to-day life right here and right now? And so, my brothers and sisters, let me encourage you right here, right now, take all of your worries, put all of your cares, put all of your concerns into that empty tomb of Christ Jesus and go to bed without them. No more worries about whether there will be enough to pay your bills or feed your families. No more worries about your health or the health of someone you love. No more worries about all the stress that I know you're feeling right now. Christ is risen, and the risen Christ can take care of all of those worries, and he will. And right here, right now, let me encourage each and every one of you to take all of your grumpiness and put it into Jesus' empty tomb and wake up tomorrow going to work and going to school happy. No more dread about that boss or supervisor or special customer who makes life so challenging for you. No more dread about your school subjects or school work or school classmates or school teachers who make your life so difficult at school. Christ is risen. And that risen Christ has power to bear to take care of every one of those situations at school and at work for you and with you. And let me urge you right here, right now, take all of your spiritual laziness and all of your apathy and put that into Christ's tomb and leave it there. No more, oh, I guess I better start showing up for church a little more often. No more, oh, I better be a little more generous in my offerings to the Lord. No more, oh, I guess I better be behaving myself a little bit better. No, Christ is risen. Risen to new and glorious life, and you are risen to new and glorious life with him. Christ is risen. You are on fire to listen to him. You are on fire to give to him. You are on fire to live for him. The resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead makes all the difference in the world in your life. Thomas saw it. John wrote about it. Now let's let you and me live it today and forever. Amen. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We join together in confessing our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. At this time we present our offerings to the Lord. Please join me in the responsive prayers of God's people. We have been given life by the once crucified and now risen Christ, so let us pray to our Father who has lavished his love on us. God of love and life, we see what kind of love you have given to us, that we who were born cut off from you should now be called children of God. You have baptized us into the death and resurrection of your Son. Keep us steadfast in faith so that we live according to your will and so all people can see that you have made us your children. Lord, in your mercy, God of love and life, we confess that by our sins we killed the author of life, and we believe that for us you raised him from the dead. Give us humble hearts that daily repent and turn again so that our sins are blotted out and so that, living in righteousness, we look forward to the return of Christ, our Savior. Lord, in your mercy, God of love and life, because we need to hear constantly that Christ suffered and on the third day rose, provide your people with workers who never tire of telling us how you have loved us. Bless those who are preparing to be pastors, teachers, and servants of all kinds in your church. Give them faithful teachers, provide for their needs and the needs of their families, and give them an enduring faith in your risen Son. Lord, in your mercy, God of love and life, as you open the scriptures to your disciples, open those scriptures to teach us. Give us a hunger for your word. Bless the Sunday school, elementary school, Lutheran high school, and Bible classes of our congregation. Send your promised Holy Spirit to those who teach us so that we may know and believe everything written about Jesus in the law, the prophets, the Psalms, and the New Testament. Lord, in your mercy, God of love and life, through doctors, nurses, medical workers, therapies, and medications, heal the people we know who need your care. Give them faith that relies on you and provide for all their needs. Lord, in your mercy, Lord God, as we look to your Son, Jesus, we see how you showed your faithfulness to us and demonstrated your great love for us. Hear our prayer for Maddie Stevens and Cody Rasmussen, who will be married this coming Saturday, and fill their marriage with your abiding grace. Direct their eyes to Jesus, and so help them fulfill their marriage vows and remain committed to each other all their days. Teach them the many excellent qualities of your love, that their hearts may overflow with those same qualities to the praise of your name. God of love and life, take away our fear of death, strengthen us for lives of service, and fill us with Easter joy as we look forward to our eternal home with you in heaven. Hear our prayers, Heavenly Father, because of your crucified and risen Son, in whose name we now join in praying. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord God, our Heavenly Father, pour out the Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep us strong in your grace and truth. Protect and comfort us in all temptation, and bestow on us your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. My life, my strength, my song, this cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. Heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease, my comforter. Here in the love of Christ I stand. In the ground his body light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. In life, no fear in death, this is in me, from life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No more of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand, turns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I stand. Indeed. Thank you, Salem Lutheran Praise Band. I'll introduce them to you. With most of the vocals today was Melissa DeRozier. And then next to her is Dave Farstead. Next to him is Colton Berger, sorry about that. And then Bill Schendel on guitar and drums, and Missy Klein was on the piano for us today. So again, we thank them. Maybe another way to respond to their playing for us today is with jealousy that we don't have something like this at Mount Olive. Envy, maybe a desire to, let's go over to Salem and join there and so we can hear them. But maybe the best way would be to have this inspire us maybe to look into something like this for our own congregation someday. I think we have the talents. We just have to unearth them and uncover them. And I want to tell you that they're not asking for any donation today from us or anything, any kind of payment. It was very obvious, even from their rehearsal yesterday and from their performing today, that this is just something they do out of love for their Savior and love for the Savior's people, too. So we thank them for that again. There's a couple of other announcements today. And let me get those announcements for you. First of all, right after our church service, there is going to be Sunday school. Children will meet down in the gym and then split up for their classes. No adult Bible class, because in the place of Bible class today, there will be our quarterly voters meeting. That's going to take place here in the sanctuary, not in the fellowship hall. The fellowship hall is set up for something different for this afternoon. But you can go to the fellowship hall if you're a voter. Grab a cup of coffee, sign in, get your voter's packet and all the other sheets, and then come back here for the voter's meeting. It shouldn't be a really long one. What is going on in the fellowship hall today is that there's going to be a Lutheran Women's Missionary Society rally that we're hosting here at Mount Olive, beginning with a meal at noon and then a presentation at 1. You're invited to stick around and come for that as well. Of all the folks of our congregation are by default members of the LWMS. And so with that in mind, our ushers are standing by at the doors to collect a door offering to support the work of the Lutheran Women's Missionary Society. If you can, give them a gift today for that. The flowers up here in front are from the Diane Benson funeral this past week on Thursday. We thank the family for allowing us to use those flowers and all the helpers that helped out for that funeral. It was a big one for a weekday funeral. And then, let me see, finally, believe it or not, the grass is going to start growing and we will need to mow it. And we have volunteers that do that. If you can help with that, there is a sign-up sheet on one of the counters in the back. Do that today. That is it for our announcements. I hope you have a great rest of the day. I'll greet you in the entryway.
Thank you.